So as Mark has has explained, and one of the most difficult things that is more interesting for me is the data modeling. So the document structure allows you to do a lot of different things, and for me at least has been difficult because I worked more than 20 years now with the relational databases. So when I joined MongoDB 2 years ago, it was very difficult to change mindset, no? So adapt to a different way to model the data. One good exercise that I have done was about the time series, the Internet of Things, and so on. And so this is why I wanted to reproduce it. So we will see some slides, and then I will show some practical application. So we do an example. First of all, that is the most important concept. That is that if you think that you want to write, to design an ideal schema for the Internet of Things, forget it, because it doesn't exist. Why not? Because the Internet of Things requires is stressing a lot the hardware and software, but also requires a lot of flexibility, because we have billions of new devices that are connected and will start in the next year to talk each other, no? To exchange data each other. And it's difficult to predict today what will happen. The same, so is that the structure and the rigid tables, no? And the rigid schema, then of course we are not helping, no? Because we cannot predict how we will evolve also our devices, not only how they will communicate each other, but also the devices itself will evolve. And I will show you a typical example, not the one of the problem. The problem are the wells is where there is the water, huh? And the city. And you have a sensor in the wells that is same just the water level. Very simple. So the typical architecture that you can have is two tables on the relational world with the city and the wells with the water level. So the wells then will be, you will add, no, rows every time the sensor of the wells is sending the water level. So in this way you can keep the history, you can do the graph and so on, average, you can do what you want. Of course the number of records that you have that in the wells tables depends on the number of sensors, the wells, and the how often, no, is sending an information every minute, every 15 minutes, every hour, and so on. Then, one day, someone will come up after 2 years, for example, saying, but now we have these generators that are connected to internet, so why we are not using them, no? So to see the live data. So what happens then to our data structure? Means that we need to evolve it. You need to create another table with the power plant, and we need to add a field to the wells table. But inside I have 2 years of data. Probably I have billions of rows. And I need to do alter table then. So every time I connect the new sensors, or I evolve a sensor, or I add new devices, probably I need to add the column there, to add another table, that means to do joins and so on. So this is why the relational approach has been so difficult to be adopted, no, in the Internet of Things and in general to the time series implementation. On the opposite, what we want to propose is which is slide, thank you, is to handle the data with a document-oriented approach, where, for example, here I have one document per well with all the data inside. We will see how to implement this. Of course, the design goal of the time series are very difficult, because we need at the same time to have a write performance. We need to write a lot. But we need also read the performance because we need the analytical queries. So we do range queries, big queries. So we need an infrastructure that is able to optimize at the same time heavy write load and big range read. It's very difficult. Of course, in the meantime, we'll also go to have a compromise of memory utilization and the resources utilization, because otherwise, so I need to achieve with a realistic amount of hardware, because of course the answer can be very easy, no? So I buy a huge, a big cluster, a huge machine, I spend millions of euros, so the point, no? So this is the point, is to release a amount of hardware and to, so if you have infinite, of course, the resources, then will be fine. But in the real world, of course, it's different. So I will show you what we can do. So with the document per event, per minute, hour, and so on. You will see what does it mean. So the classic implementation is to reproduce what you do with a relational table, with just a simple table, that is to write one record for each event. Suppose that here you have a sensor, no, that is sending the temperature. So then you will have one row, one record, one document with the device ID, the timestamp, and the temperature. So if you have 10,000 of devices that are sending the temperature every minute, no, so then you will have 600,000 documents per minute, no, per hour. And so on. So the problem here is that this approach is insert driven, so is very fast in insert, because to insert rows in the database is very fast. But then the problem is starting when you have to read the data, when you want to do some analytics, when you want to do what is the average temperature in this area. So in this way you have to manage a huge amount of reads, and then become very difficult to manage because the response time then is starting to be very high. Then it's difficult to do real-time analytics because you have to aggregate all the time a huge amount of data. So we will try to minimize this and also to have a better management, because if I keep this rate, means that after 1 year probably I will have billions of documents inside that are not easy to manage. So what I can do is the simple thing that you can do, saying okay, but instead of writing all the samples, no, but I need probably the minimum granularity that I need is I don't know, per minute, and I need only to know what is the average. So what I can do is the sum, the number of samples, and so I can calculate the average. So instead of doing an insert, I will do an update here within a minute. And then I just increase the input counter. That's it. Of course, in this way you lose all the details of all the samples that you can store in another collection, and you have some pre-aggregated things. That is the same approach that you can do with the relational database. Instead of having two different collections, one with all the samples and one with the pre-aggregation, we can do a kind of merge. So we can enable the data types that we have in this JSON format that are not very only the simple things. So for now, for what we have seen, that is also what we have done for years with the relation world, every field has only one value. No? But we are talking about the JSON format. So you can have different data type, like the vectors, like subdocuments, and so on. So here is using subdocuments, but I prefer to use the arrays that we will see later. So what you can do then is try to compress to compress the number of documents, and instead of storing one single value for each data type, you can store arrays. For example, here is the document per minute, where I have an array of 60 elements. So then I will search the document, and then I will update the slot in the array to relate to the specific second that I have there. So in this way, what I get is that I change the workload, because instead of doing a lot of insert, I start doing up days. But why I'm doing this? Because here I have a document, then per minute, no? And then I have all the seconds there. And in this document I have all the details per second, and in the meantime I can also add here the pre-aggregation, the aggregation per minute, what we have seen before. So the total of the samples and the sum of all the samples. So it means that when I do an update, I can update the slot here, or the sequence 68, I write the value there, and then in the meantime, at the same update statement, I update also the pre-aggregation per minute, or the total per minute. This, of course, you can do it also to changing the granularity. Instead of doing per minute, you can do also by hour. So in this way you can have a document per hour that is containing all the seconds. There's an array of 3600 elements. The problem is that to update the values here is very expensive, because you need to traverse the list. So you need a lot of steps to reach the right element to update. So this is not good. So what you can do then is a mix. It is this. So we can have one document per hour. In this case, where I have an array of 60 elements. Each element is a sub-document that will contain an array of 60 elements that are the second. So when I do an update, I have the means. The second, I just need to find the right place for the element. I update. Then I can update the totals for that minute, but I can update also the total for the hour, because I have a document per hour. So in one step, just one update statement, then I can update all the chain following the time hierarchy that I have in the document. That is the different approach. So, what is important is that using the arrays I still be able to access directly the samples, the values, because I can do queries also on arrays, of arrays and so on. I will show you practically what this doesn't mean. This is less complicated than looking at the slide. And what is the impact on the performance? If it's working. It's some months that I'm not using it. So I will do the two. You ready? It's okay? So, I will do two things. One is to fulfill a collection where we have one document per event. So, it's a simulation of a sensor that is just writing a temperature, the temperature is just a random number. And I will populate it using the bulk insert. Also, we will insert a lot of data related to some numbers of these. So I will create this function in my local MongoDB, and we will see if it works. Compile it, it's compiled. Now, and we need to execute it. So bulk row insert the number of devices 1000. So in the simulation here I suppose that the device is sending information every 50 minutes, so 4 in an hour, so it will be 96 in a day, so for 3 days will be more or less 3 million of rows. So now this back is three. So, let's check what it's doing. Okay, the MongoStat is the tool that we use to understand what is doing the database inside. And you can see it's writing. It will take more or less 1 minute. You are familiar with the MongoStat? No, never? So the MongoStat is just showing some internal metrics, split between the operation that are running inside the database. Then you have some information about the memory, so the amount of memory mapped, the virtual memory size, the memory resident, and then here are the faults. The faults are the page faults. So the traditional, so the old storage engine of MongoDB, because in 3.0, no, we have added the new storage engine called Wild Tiger, no, is using an MMap approach, so it's mapping all the data file in memory. So when it's accessing to the pages, then when it is not finding the information in memory, then it's raising a page fault, and that page is read from disk. So you will have a page fault and then a page to read from disk. Then here are index misses. Misses means that when the not defined are using indexes that are not in memory. So he has to go to disk to read the index to do the scan. Then we have so then we have some information about the queries that are the queued, so the read write operation that are queued due to locks. So. Okay, so seems to have finished. So let's check what he has done. No? There is this table row count. Okay, 2,080,000 rows. Okay. So I have some queries that that we can do. For example, I want. First of all, I show you what is the content of the document. It's very simple, no? So I use underscore ID, the ID, that is the ID of the device, the timestamp, and then the temperature. That is very simple. So I want to do some aggregation. Let's do some examples. So in the example here, I will do the aggregation of the average temperature by sensor ID. This is using the aggregation framework. That is with the function. The function aggregate. Then there is the group, that is the operation. So I'm grouping based on underscore ID and with the average of temperature. And has done it. So and the sort is for ID underscore ID. So the ID of the sensor. So here he has done the aggregation on more or less 3 million of rows. In let's say how much time he has spent. For a second. Take more or less 1 second. That is not bad. Then I wanted to do, for example, this. That is the average temperature for each sensor, no, based on the hour, no, so for each hour, no, so this is the cumulative average for hours. That is not very interesting. What is interesting, no, is this one, the most interesting. So this is the aggregation based on for each sensor to have the average for each hour. So it's a, you will have a result 24 rows. Oh. So what is happening here? So he is doing a lot of grouping, then he has to sort and so on, and he has finished the memory. And so what we need to do is to add at the end a parameter that is allow disk used true, because I don't have enough free memory to manage this. Okay. It's not very slow, eh? 7 seconds. So it took 7 seconds to do, to do this NAS aggregation. So I have the sensor ID, the hour, and then the average temperature for each hour for each sensor. This is the most complex aggregation that we can have. So the concept here is to try to recalculate some information and to reduce also the number of documents, that here are 2 million. But because I have only 3 days, no? But if I have more devices, more days, then it's easy to have to reach 1 billion of documents. That is becoming too much, too complicated. So what I wanted to do is to reduce the number of documents and to recalculate some operation that will speed up the average operation that I must do. So to do this, I prepared the document as I said before. Is doing this. So I will have a document structure that has an array, is one document per day, and I will have an array of 24 elements. Each one contains that are the hours. Each element of the array contains is a sub-document that contains the pre-aggregation for that hour, the total of that hour, plus an array of 60 elements that are the minus. And inside the minus, then I have the same, I have the aggregation. And then I have the total aggregation per day. So when I do the update of the document, because I'm not doing an insert, what I do? First of all, I do a push, because at the end of this matrix, the end the element per minute, I want to keep all the samples. So it's not only the pre-aggregation, I want also to keep the samples, because I want to query the samples. Then, if I have more samples in the same minute, then I write them in an array. In this case, I think that I have done just a total per hour. So in this case, I have four samples per hour, because it's every 15 minutes. So what I will do then is the total per day, the total per hours, and then for each hour, an array of the samples. The goal here is to reduce by 24 per 4, so by 96 times, the number of the documents inside the collection, and to have already some pre-aggregated data to run the queries. So we try to execute it, and then we see the result and how the documents are done. I will do the same. So bulk our insert. 10,000 and 3 days. So you see that he has done initially some inserts, because he has created the documents, because I have one document per day. So first he's creating 10,000 devices. So 10,000 documents per 3 days, so 30,000 of documents. And then it's just updating them. You see, the update speed is much lower than the insert rate. So the price for this is to have already pre-aggregated some information, is to slow down a little bit the write speed, because the update are slower than the insert. And But then the benefit is, of course, to have already a lot of information pre-aggregated that, we can speed up the reads. So if we, so this here we need to wait a little bit. So I will, open another shell. So I have this, it's called hours. Let's see how is done a document now. This is one of the empty document. It isn't populated yet. Take some time, but so this is the how will be the document in the form. This is empty document, you know? So it will be, so the key is the same as before, the sensor ID, the times, and then I have hours, that is an array of 24 elements, and then each one will have the pre-aggregation and the array of samples that I don't have yet because is empty. Okay, we need to wait that is populating them. We take 3 minutes probably. So what I can try to do is just to show you an example while it's populating it. Is I can do a query where okay. So here has already written something. As you can see, the documents are complicated a little bit. So this is how they will be, no? So I will have the key, sensor ID, and the timestamp, and hours, that is this array of 24 elements. Then each element has this, so the total temperature and the number of samples, and then I have the samples. So every time I need to write samples, I will do a push into the field that is hours dot the number of hours, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on, dot samples. I do a push inside here. Then I update the field hours dot the number of the hours dot no sample plus one, so it's a link, and then I sum also the temperature and so on. Then, if we go to the end of the document, so at the end of 24 elements, I have also the total number of samples of the day, that are 96, 4 per hour, for 24 hours, and the total temperature. So in this way, it will be easy to calculate the temperature. Now let's see what it's doing. Oh. Is finished. Okay, so now we try to execute the same queries. The queries are a little bit more complicated than the previous one with the one document per event approach. But, so for example, we can reproduce this one, is this one. Let's see the difference. This is per device. This is per hour. Ah, this is the global, so it's not useful. This is ID, media divide, total sample, and so on. So this is the aggregation per our device. Hour yes, I have put the I don't know why it's not showing the hour field. So this is the average that what we have seen before, that was taking 7 seconds. Was taken before? Oh, I don't know. I repeat it. It's not going to the log. Because it's too fast. Of course it's too fast, because I have already all the information. I wanted to know the average for each hour. Are already there. I need only to divide the two numbers, and that's it. Okay? What is important then is that I have all the information in the sample array, so in this way I can do all the queries also to all the single samples. So I have the pre-aggregation to all the level of the time hierarchy, but I have also the raw values. For example, I can do queries like hours dot find, so try to find all the devices that had the temperature greater than 20 degrees. No? So find the here is hours dot samples, greater than equal, of course, yes, everybody. Let's reduce it. Okay. So here is just showing all the documents. I can extract only the underscore id dot id. So it's showing all the sensors that they had the temperature greater than 20, and this is using the hours documents, so the document with the biggest format with all the aggregation, this one, okay? Because thanks to the capability of MongoDB to access all the fields to all the level of the hierarchy and to do, of course, queries in the samples, then I can do it very, very easily. Ah, by the way, that I haven't any index on that. I'm querying by temperature greater than 20, and I don't have any index. It's doing a full scan of all the values.
If you have millions of samples, you will create huge list for the debates.
No, it depends on the granularity. You decide the granularity of your document. So in this case, I decide to use one document per day, per sensor, per device. So I have maximum, if my devices are sending one event every 15 minutes, then I will have a maximum of 96 events per document. So then you can decide the hierarchy. It depends also on how often the sensor are sending the data. If you are sending data every minute, then probably you per day is still good. If per second, probably is not. So then you do a document per hour instead of per day, and so on. And then also depends on the number of sensors that you have and so on. But so this is the concept, is that you can complicate the structure in this way. With one update statement, you can insert the value and add, precalculate, this was the average, but you can do, of course, what you want, to all the level of the hierarchy. And then you can still access the raw values to do queries. So that is the same that if I was doing in the raw, I was called the temp. No, so if I do temp greater than was 18. Sorry, it's mixing one bracket. No, that is the same. Yeah, no, you can do the same kind of query, accessing still the raw values. So this is why for me the array approach is great, because you can store complex document with already pre-calculated a lot of values, and you do while you are writing in one single document, and they're still atomic, no? Because ODB has the atomicity at the document level. It's quite easy to implement. There are a lot of companies that are already using this structure. For example, Bosch is using similar, but is using subdocuments instead of arrays. The problem is that if you use subdocuments, you are not able to access to do the queries to the raw values. That with the arrays you can still do it. So this is the structure that I'm helping also a lot of automotive companies and so on, for example, sensor for the cars and so on, to store, to have this kind of structure, because in this way they can do real-time monitoring. No? For example, we have implemented this structure for a French company that is a utility. They have counters for the water. I cannot say the name. And they are doing this because they want to understand in real time if they have problems in the consumption of the water, because they can have two things. The first, you can have a problem somewhere, you can have a loss of water somewhere, or you can have someone stealing water somewhere. No? That I thought that was happening only in Italy, but it's happening also in France. But this is important, no? To have something that is able to query in real time the information. So to do that, you need to pre-aggregate the data in this way. Tell me.
Why should we draw the line between making a single document more complex and using multiple documents?
So it depends on what is the... So if you can create one document, then you can have multiple values already calculated in all the hierarchy that you have inside the document. So it doesn't matter if the documents are complicated, if you see, because are not done to be read by humans, also must be read by a machine. So who cares if they are complicated? We are talking about arrays. So if you then you make one big document with a long hierarchy, then you can pre-calculate a lot of things, no, in all the hierarchy. So it's more convenient. And so in this way you can save a lot of aggregation queries because you have already all the values.
Yeah, for example, you split your recording by days. Why yes. Don't we run it by month?
Yeah, you can do that. No, of course you can do that.
But when do we know when we're going to farm?
So there is a limit in terms of performance, because consider that the arrays, also if are stored at arrays, is not accessing directly the element in the array, but is traversing all the array. So if you have a very long arrays, then to update the last element of the array, for example, yes, to traverse the whole array. So if you do arrays of arrays of arrays of arrays of arrays, of course, then it's becoming slower, because it has to traverse a lot of elements. So for example, in this case that I have done 24 elements, an array of 24 elements, and that's it. So at 23, so 11 in the evening, it has to traverse 24 elements, not one that is good. Then it has to do a push of an element in another array, that in my case has a maximum of 4 elements. So we do 23 plus No, so will be, if you are storing the fourth element, so you will be 3. So 23 plus 3, 26. This is good. Then if you start to do arrays of arrays, so 24 for the hours, 60 for the minutes, 30 for the months, then you can start probably to do more than 100 of steps to update the last one. So there is also a limit in terms of performance, when it makes sense. Depends also what is the insert rate that you have and what is the read, no, that you have. No? So in this case, I think that is already good enough to save lot of time in reading, no? Because it's from seconds to milliseconds, no? So it's good enough. So then if you need to do months, then you can do an aggregate, but you are aggregating, so in this case, some 30 documents per month. So if you wanted to do a query for 2 months, it's 60 documents compared to 1,000, no? Or 10,000 of documents. So this was just a quick example, no, to show how you can play with the documents, no, that are not just a plain structure, no, you were used to play with the records and tables and so on in a relational, but you have to think out of the box and create something that is completely different from what we are seeing now. No? So to use MongoDB document approach, you have to switch the brain. So that, at least in my experience, was the most difficult part. Then we have seen with the market presentation, we have characteristics like the sharding, but these are normal infrastructure things that today, more or less, every database has, no? The availability, the sharding, some normal things. But to play with documents in this way, so this is the big advantage and the most difficult thing. That's it. No, there is only one thing that I wanted to show that is funny. About that, so Mark was talking about the sharding. No, the sharding. You know what is the first example and the great example of sharding that everybody had at home, at least the youngest probably know. But who is very young, probably not. But the others, they all had a sharding at home. You know what was? What is? The encyclopedia. The encyclopedia, the first was the Britannica, no? In the 70s, 71. And they used exactly the sharding approach with the range of words, able to split in multiple volume, with the range, no, for each volume. This is the sharding. The sharding is exactly this, the encyclopedia. That was the very old example of this. How you scale, you add the volume. How the encyclopedia evolved in these years. No? So sometimes we are using, no, technology things that from a practical point of view have already been used for a very long time. That's it.